Meet the Beatles, Ed Sullivan, February 1964. Beatlemania struck the United States. Beatlemania actually started in, was it October 13th, something like that, 1963, London Palladium, where they did this variety show and everyone started screaming. The kids just went out of their minds, started screaming, and the next day the newspapers coined the phrase Beatlemania, or the word Beatlemania, to describe what's going on. Beatlemania started then. In February 1963, well, 57, February 64, 56 years later, 54, how many years has it been? 53 years? 1964, 1917, no, it's more than that, isn't it? So, my gosh, 74, 84, 94, 104, 114, that's 50, 53 years. It's, here we are, and we back off to 213, so 49 years, I think, 213. Pope Benedict resigned. Pope Benedict resigned. Welcome to the video, everyone. We're going to start off with Pope Benedict. You thought it would be the Beatles? No, it's Pope Benedict. He resigned February... Could have been February 13th, actually. He resigned in February of 2013. And... he said, you know, my health, my energy and health is not enough to handle the responsibilities of the papacy. Well, as the first pope in 600 years, almost 600 years to resign. And it was a huge mystery. And there's been, you know, tremendous amount of speculation over that. And today the Holy Spirit said, why don't you look at it this way? And it said, could it be that the Pope Benedict resigned because he knew Jesus was back? Came back into the world, which would be the end of the papacy, right? Yeah, because the popes are just holding the office of the papacy until Jesus returns. So Pope Benedict, we know that Jesus was here in 2015, in May 1st, 2015, because he addressed the whole world in spirit. I'm back, and I'm here to relate with you as friends. With all of you as a friend. And so what the Holy Spirit suggested was Jesus may have come back earlier than that and just didn't announce it to the world. There's no reason why he would announce it the first day he returned. He'd say, hey, everybody, I'm back. He may have come back and then let things settle and then ultimately address everybody in the world. He may have told some of us in the world that he was back in 213. And this information may have well been told to Pope Benedict. So being the good Catholic and person of faith that he is, he said, well, it's my duty to step down. It's my duty to step down. And I can't control what the rest of the church does, but my duty is to say that's it. Step down. I'm not Pope anymore. So in his book, Last Testament, everybody's been claiming this is why he stepped down. In 2016, he wrote a book, I think, was it Final Testament? Maybe it's Final Testament or Last Testament, Final Testament, Last Testament, where they asked him about all this stuff, the scandals and all this stuff in the church. There's all these leaked letters and bank scandal, et cetera, et cetera. And he just brushed it aside and said, no, that has nothing to do with it. He just said that these are just human failings. I've never been bothered by human failings at all. And I believe him. I mean, I really like Pope Benedict. He was very direct, very strict, very disciplined, very abstract mind. And so when he says, you know, that stuff happens everywhere, which is true. And so that didn't shock me. I wasn't, you know, had nothing to do with me stepping down. And I believe him. So that's the secular people, the worldly people thinking, oh, because that's what upsets them. But someone like Pope Benedict would not been upset enough to resign. No pope resigns. They die in office. So it had to be something way, way bigger than that. Well, my energy isn't good to deal with. no pope's energy is very good when they get old, but that's the tradition, right? So, it's a very strong possibility, suggested to me by the Holy Spirit, that he knew Jesus had returned. So I don't know the exact day that Jesus returned, but it could have been as early as 213 now, looking back. So it's been over 2 years since then, between then and 2000, May 1st, 2015, when he addressed all of us in spirit, okay, not as flesh, but as spirit. He spoke to our spirits, and I was able to be aware of that. When I was dreaming, I became aware that this is Jesus and he's addressing the whole world. I was completely aware of it, wide aware of it in spirit. And I saw everybody in the world, the vast multitudes. He addressed everyone. So it's been almost 2 years since that had happened. We're coming up on the second 2 year anniversary here in less than a month. So 2 year interval between Benedict, possible his return, Benedict's resignation, and his address in the world. Maybe another 2 year interval between addressing the world and what? It's amazing to me that Christians, Catholics, say that there's no such thing as the rapture in the Bible. Because the final words of Jesus before he left, he says, "Look, don't be bothered, right? Don't be bothered. I'm going away for a while, and I'll return. I'm going to, what did he call it? Provide a dwelling place for you. I'm going to make a dwelling place for you, and then I'm going to come back at the end of the age and take you there to dwell with me." He said, don't be worried. There's my father's mansion has many rooms in it, many, many rooms in it. I'm going to prepare a dwelling place for you, and I shall come back for you." Okay, at the end of the age, he's going to come back. At some point, he's going to come back and take us to his dwelling place, so we can live there with him. So we won't have to go through the troubles. It's very clear in the Bible that the idea is that there's tremendous troubles coming upon the world. So if that isn't a rapture, I don't know what is. Jesus coming back to the world and taking those who want to go, taking them to a different dwelling place. I mean, that's a rapture. You're leaving this planet to go dwell with Jesus. It's right there in black and white in the Bible. You can't possibly miss that. And yet they seem to miss that. It's just, it's astonishing. What can Jesus do? What can any of us do when doubt is in charge of our, when the ego, which is doubt, which is self-evaluation, which is doubt, is in charge of our perception? We're going to just be, really foolish, unfortunately. That's unavoidable. So who knows what exactly Jesus will do, but certainly there seems to be a movement towards troubles in this world of a very strong variety. So maybe we'll find out soon that he'll throw, the other shoe. Drop the other shoe. I expect it. It will happen to somebody like Bob, like, oh my gosh. And so I'm preparing, 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 preparing. And today's no exception. Doing the wow practice to a tremendous extent. Having just a flow of breakthroughs, of I can't even remember what they are. If I try to remember, I get jittery because there's so many of them. I can't keep up with it all. So 1963 was Surfing USA. The Beach Boys broke big, and Dion was winding down with Drip Drop, Ruby Baby, and then in August of '63, Donna, the Prima Donna. I think one of his very top songs, maybe the best, the hardest song to sing. I was singing it many, many times today, and it just, man, I just can't. I don't quite have it. It is just very tough. He's got that high voice. If he dropped down some, it would be more doable. But anyway, it's a challenge. And that was no Beatles songs in '63 in the United States. In '63 in the UK, they released some songs, but Beatlemania didn't hit in the U.S. until 1964. 1964. That's when I Get Around by the Beach Boys. I think Help Me Rhonda was there too. A number of really great songs by the Beach Boys in '64. But Beatlemania had struck at that point and was just Huge, huge, huge. So we're going back to 1963, before all of that, the energy shift, before the energy shift happened. Tuning into that. Now, what happened today? What happened today was I suddenly became aware of something. About dreaming. And I realized, let's say, listen to this. This is so vitally important, if you can tune into this. So we're leaving that energy to the Beatles, that came in with the Beatles, 53 years of it. We're leaving that now, putting it to the side, and we're going back to a quieter, more gentle time, where people were able to listen a lot better than they are now. Now they're just screaming at one another. I tried to dig up some information on Benedict, and you come across some articles, and it's just, I mean, the media is so terrible. Don't need to say anything. That's how terrible it is. No words can describe it. And so you go back to 1963, and wow, totally different vibe. Totally different vibe. Now, dreaming. I bring this up because I started to fall into dreaming, I think around 1964, when Beatlemania struck. Before that, I was very aware of being. Very psychic, very aware. And then I remember the Beatlemania and then the Beach Boys, I get around it. The whole confluence in 64, I believe, I would have been 8 years old, I probably started drifting off into dreaming. Now, what do we mean drifting off into dreaming? Spiritually speaking. Okay, let's use the analogy. Let's say you're in a room, and you lie down on a bed, and there's some people talking on them. Someone maybe's in the room, they're talking on the telephone. And so you're kind of lying there, kind of resting, and you hear them talking on the telephone, and say, okay, someone's here in the room talking on the telephone. And then you kind of drift off, sort of start drifting off to sleep. And what do you start dreaming? Well, you dream a dream that you're in a room with somebody else is in the room, they're talking on the telephone. Okay? You start off dreaming like that. But you're not aware that you're dreaming, because the segue between dreaming and awakening is you dream of the same thing you're experiencing while you're awake. Except the difference is big, isn't it? It's very important, because then in the dream, somebody comes, knocks at the door and says, hey, I lost my cat. Do you know where it is? Can you help me go look for it? So you go out, you start looking for the cat. Next thing you know, you're down by a river, and like you get swept away, by the river, and the river takes you down, and you fall off a cliff, and you go down the cliff like that, and then suddenly you're flying, and you land on a beach somewhere, and then on it, right? I mean, you're on this crazy, and you find yourself driving through a jungle-like city, and you go into a room there, and all these weird people, or stuff's going on. It's just like bizarre, right? It's like, wow, this is horrible. What's going on? What happened to my room and the person's talking to my room? They're gone. I lost them. I don't even know how to get back to there. Okay. But as we know, in dreaming, you never left the room. And the person in the room is still there talking on the telephone. Okay. Whereas if you were awake, you would know that they didn't go anywhere. Okay? They didn't go anywhere. Everything's exactly as it was before, if you were awake. So the insidiousness of dreaming, I'm waking up to dreaming. It's not normal. It's not natural to fall asleep and dream at all. It's not at all. It's a disease. It's a sickness. It's a defense system, actually. Ananda Maimon never slept at all. Never fell asleep, never slept. She said, I don't need to sleep at all. You all need that because that's a defense system. She would close her eyes so people would think she's sleeping, But she said, I'm just as awake now as I would be if I'm talking with you or walking on the street or anything. I don't sleep at all. So I see that dreaming, sleeping, dreaming is a mental trick, a defense system that we're using to deceive ourselves, to delude ourselves. It's our habit. It's a habit we have of doubt, isn't it? Of doubting what's going on and detaching, believing that we're detached from what's going on. And again, the whole key is that we start out our dreams registering what's going on around us and dreaming of that. So we don't know we're dreaming. We don't know we've fallen asleep. So this should be ringing some bells in everyone. Say, wait a minute. This sounds like meditation where the mind, they say, hey, the mind thinks it's awake. This is my mind says, I know what's going on. I'm accurate. But it's actually asleep. It's just, it's in a dream state where it's not able to evaluate what's really going on in reality at all, even though it's dreaming of what it last registered of reality, you see. And then from there, anything at all can happen in a dream. So this is, you have to, yeah, I've never seen this before. I said, oh my gosh. So we trick ourselves. Dreaming is a trick. We're tricking ourselves, thinking we're experiencing reality in a dream, but we're not at all. And we believe that we're experiencing reality because we first dreamed of the way things are. In reality, we started out with our dream that way. So we didn't realize, we said, no, this is still reality. Except it was imagery. It was representational imagery instead of beingness and awareness and beingness. It was imagery. And then we tell ourselves, no, I'm awake. And this is just, and then the dream, then we think that's what's actually happening to reality. All the stuff we're dreaming must be real. Because we don't realize we're asleep. We don't realize we are asleep. Just like when we fall asleep, like an example I used, we don't realize we're asleep. We don't know it. Because we started our dreaming out. When we fell asleep, we went into dreaming, we started out with what we know is there in the room. So we said, well, I'm not dreaming because I'm still experiencing what's going on. No, we're experiencing a memory of what's going on. A memory of what's going on. An image memory of what's going on. And then we manipulate that image memory from there and we start creating all sorts of other imagery and imagination. Okay? So this is really super important, but it's not something that can be just easily explained. You know, you just have to sort of take it to heart and one day it'll occur to you. You know, this is what happens. Something just simply occurs to you suddenly. And you say, hey, wait a minute. I never even thought of that before. Oh my gosh, that's very important. So I don't know what the result of this will be, but certainly, to me, I said, well, I need to wake up. I'm dreaming. I need to wake up. How do you wake up? And you wake up by flattening your evaluation of the dream. So you stop trying to evaluate the dream. It's a dream. Don't try to evaluate a dream. It's all make-believe. That keeps you dreaming. In fact, the dream is evaluation. What we're dreaming is a dream of evaluation. We started evaluating. So at some point in my life, I started evaluating instead of just knowing. I used to just know, and then I started evaluating. And that's when I fell asleep. Like Adam and Eve, they say, fell asleep and dreamed a dream of good and evil, good and bad, which is evaluation, a dream of evaluation, and they haven't woken up yet. Okay, that is really, really true. This points to the mind. So, how do we wake up? By flattening evaluation, the wow practice. The wow practice wakes us up. Apex wow yogin. Wow, I am an apex wow yogin for sure. I'm practicing the wow practice all the time. A lot now. Not all day, but I put on a lot of bursts during the day. Like I really get it. And it's working. see the dynamics of dreaming like this. It's like, wow. Don't evaluate the dream. This is all a dream. What we're experiencing is our imagination. Nothing is as we are seeing it right now, as we believe it to be. Everything is just, we can't even say until we experience it. Okay, so we shouldn't try to say what is reality, what is the peace of God, what does it feel like, what is this, until we experience it. We have to experience it, because otherwise we're just evaluating via speculation, trying to draw some value. What's the value like? It's all value everywhere, always. So there's no evaluation of reality. So our attempt to evaluate it is a dream. That's what plunges us into a dream. As soon as we're trying to evaluate reality, we actually plunge into a dream, but we're not aware that we have plunged into a dream. None of us are aware we're dreaming. Just like when we go to sleep, are we aware we're dreaming? No, we're not. Very rarely. Sometimes you have a lucid dream, which is really good. And I've had quite a bit of that where I do stuff in the dream that's clearly, I say, wait a minute, you know, this can alter this. There's some consciousness, awareness there. But the bigger picture is, how do we really awaken from the dream? Not by speculating on what reality's like, not except knowing there's no evaluation. So since there's no evaluation, and we've been dreaming a dream of evaluation, what plunges us back into evaluation is our habit of evaluating. So we have to work on the habit of evaluating. And this is what we all avoid, because people were told, well, if you don't evaluate, then you're an idiot. Well, I'd rather be, you know, I don't know what's more of an idiot, to get out. Obviously, if we're asleep and we don't even know it, and we're dreaming of evaluating, where in fact reality there's nothing to evaluate, and it's a dream of fear and insecurity, that's pretty stupid. And accepting reality the way it is, you know, that's exactly perfect what we should do. So we do need to flatten evaluating. It doesn't lead to dumbness. It leads to total knowledge, total knowingness. Total knowingness. But we're afraid. So if we don't know how to evaluate, we'll just end up on the, you know, in the gutter. We won't know what to do with ourselves. That's not true at all. But it's hard to understand this. But we'll know exactly what to do in every case when we wake up. So our functioning will just be like flawlessly wonderful in terms of helping everyone else wake up. and we'll be just enjoying everything, you know, peace of God, just immensely. And so, but our habit of evaluating is what keeps us asleep, dreaming. So working on breaking the habit of evaluation is what wakes us up. But most don't want to know this because they're afraid of waking up, because they'll think it's an abyss. There's nothing to evaluate. Oh, let me go back to sleep. That must be reality. Let me go back to dreaming. But then there's no security in dreaming. It's insecure. Hallucination is insecure. And so we're constantly in seek of value, some way to fixate dreaming, fixate hallucinating, fixate the mind. And we use death as our great hope to attain fixation of mind. So it's stable. So there's a stability, feeling of like, this isn't a dream, it's stable. It'll last forever. And death and decay are how, as our greatest hope, to try to fixate the mind. That's why we've invented, imagined, pretended death, and believe that the brain is the mind. So the brain, body, die. We think that the body's not moving, that therefore the brain is fixated, meaning the mind is fixated. And then it decays, so the evidence can't come back to life. So it says, we got the evidence, okay, now destroy it. So it can't change. That can't change. This is what we've done. It's all that we've done. It's all a dream. Death is just a dream. Decay is just a dream. None of it is true. Our life is in the eternal now. It's nowhere else. There's nothing but that. There's nothing but that. All is the eternal now, right now, everywhere. All value is everywhere, always. All value is everywhere, always. That's God. So to wake up is to practice the wow practice, but most are, you know, it seems too frightening to wake up. But practice it anyway, like medicine. Just say you're sick and you need to take the medicine. And just do it. So I did a lot of that today. Just letting you know that if you're doing it, you're not the only one. Okay, I'm right there working on it frantically because I need to. My knee felt pretty good today. I did a lot of exercising. It's hurting a little bit now, but it's getting stronger. Weight's good. I ate a lot today because I worked out with weights. I did a lot of swinging with, you know, swinging with heavy weights, and I can feel it in my body. I did I think 80 was it today? 80 push-ups maybe, or maybe that was yesterday. Yeah, probably yesterday. But so I'm feeling, you know, tired and working out and. But moving good, everything's great here. As I'm pushing here, the wow practice. Not knowing exactly what's going to happen next, but full of faith and not worried about it. Says, whatever it is, it will be exactly what it needs to be. Okay, whatever it is, it'll be exactly what it needs to be. Oh, well, I know what happened. This I forgot what happened this morning. I had a dream last night. It was so extraordinary. So extraordinary. So super, 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 super positive for all of us. And it's difficult to explain it, but the dream was about Barry Bonds, the great baseball player. He's been retired now, I don't know, since maybe 10 years or so or something like that. Quite some time. And in this dream, I was by my front door, and I came out, and there was Barry Bonds. I said, "Hey, Barry, I want you to come back. I want you to play for me." He's like, "Really?" I said, "Yeah. I'm making you an offer right now to come back and play for me." Now he's been out. He's been riding bikes, doing various things. He's not in base, you know. Hasn't been playing baseball at all. And of course, Barry Bonds was really, I would say, the best hitter of all time, best slugger of all time, one of the top, you know, two or three baseball players of all time. In spite of his, you know, I. All the scandals, you know, performance-enhancing drugs, which was the spirit of the time. At that time, I understand why he did it. It's pretty complicated. So much pressure on him. He built AT&T Park. He's the guy that built it. He was the greatest player in baseball at that time. It was just a whole thing. He had to be the best to fill the stands. To keep the franchise going when they spent all the money in a new ballpark and make sure it was a success. He took all this stuff on his back. He was baseball. And then all these other guys started cheating using steroids. And he got forgotten. And he just felt that, I'm obligated. I really have an obligation to the franchise and to baseball to be the best player. So I've got to do what they're doing and level the playing field. He didn't start the steroids. It was in response to Sosa and Maguire overshadowing him. People just, Barry Bonds, who's he? I mean, Sosa and Maguire hitting like 70 home runs, I think Maguire hit, or something like that, or 71 or some ridiculous number. Sosa's hitting like 65, and they were smashing records, and everybody says, "Oh my gosh, these are the real great players, not Bonds. You know, he's hitting like 40. Bonds said, "Whoa, wait a minute. I'm way better player than these guys," and yet everyone's being deceived by this. This isn't right. This isn't right. Plus, people are thinking, well, maybe Bonds isn't so good, and he's letting down the franchise, the Giants franchise, the fan base. And he just, he's somebody who's proud of carrying this legacy and being the best. So he said, well, I've really got to do what they're doing, taking steroids. So if you put it in a total perspective, it's just like, okay, good. I said, Barry, look, everything's fine. I'm good with you. Come on back. But the interesting part was I was the base owner now. I owned the team. It was my team. And I said, I want you to come back and play for my team. And so I said, you can, we'll work you in. And so there's sort of like, I was trying to sell him on it. And he's like, oh my gosh, really? You want me back? And you believe in me? I said, yeah, I believe in you. I believe you can be just as good. I said, you're going to be just as good as you were before. And gradually I started thinking, like, hey, wait a minute, I believe he can be just as good as he used to be. And I said, and he said, well, I've been out for 10 years. I said, it doesn't matter. You're Barry Bonds. You can do anything you want. You're the greatest. And so he started warming up to the idea. He said, yeah, what? I'm kind of like, what have you been doing? He said, well, I've been doing some fishing now. I'm kind of into fishing. I said, oh yeah, how's that going? Well, I'm not really catching anything. It's really difficult. It's kind of frustrating and stuff. I said, Barry, come on back and play baseball. That's what you were born to do. So, and that's how the dream sort of went. And then I woke up, I started also thinking about it and saying, how can I get Barry to come back and play? Because I miss him. We all miss him because there's nobody like him. Now, there's nothing like him. And now the years have passed, and you look back and say, what do I miss about baseball? Barry Bonds, I miss Barry Bonds. Because there was nothing like it in history, nothing like it, his at bats. I mean, he just absolutely dominated the game like nobody ever has, him and Babe Ruth, but in the modern game, every bat was just riveting, the drama. And the other players just couldn't take it. They just walk him. They say, I can't handle this guy. Forget it. I'm just gonna intentionally walk him. I can't even pitch to him. And that's how good he was. And the tremendous, tremendous home runs he would hit, and the tremendous power, and it just is. He hit the ball so hard, and the contact was so on the sweet spot, and everything he did was so superior to anyone else. It was just, the best hitter I have ever seen, for sure. Ted Williams is really good too, but the power that Bonds had was just, amazing. It was enhanced, but he had great bat speed and power before PEDs also. The talent was just supreme there. And so there's really nothing like that really going on now. There's nothing like that. And we kind of missed the steroid era actually. That was really exciting. Very, very compelling. Very compelling. So, but he's coming back clean. He's coming back clean. I said, he understands that. And I said, but you're going to be better than you used to be, actually. You're going to be better now. You're wiser. And it's sort of like, and what was I talking about in this dream? I'm talking about myself. I'm saying to myself, come back. Self, come back to yourself. You are the self. You're the greatest. Come back and play for my team. Self playing on its own team, so to speak. Before you fell from grace, Bonds fell from grace. Before he fell from grace, he was the man, Absolutely. So I said, come back and be the man. You're still the man. And so I said, Barry, you're still the man. You never stopped being the man, actually. You just have fallen into dreaming. We fell into dreaming. So this was my own awakening. Really, I had a dream of awakening. And I said, you never stopped being the man. You've always been the man. He said, but what about this other time? I said, that's all a dream. It never happened. It never really happened. All the fall from grace, all that, it was a dream. It never happened. Come back. You're still playing for me. Everything's just the way it used to be. You've still got all the power. There's that animal again. What animal is that? Every night it's climbing some pole. I hear it scurrying around. I don't understand what's going on. should get a flashlight, shouldn't I? Figure that out. I don't have, do I have one out here? I don't think so. No. Anyway, it hasn't bothered me, whatever it is. So this was a very, very powerful dream, is that, and I realized, I haven't lost anything. I'm just as good as I've always been. This whole, for me, my fall from grace never happened. It never happened, it was just a dream. I just dreamed I fell from grace. You see, when you fall asleep, you don't realize you fell asleep, and then you have a dream of falling from grace, and you think that the dream figure that's falling from grace is not a dream, it's actually happening. But in fact, it's not happening at all. It never happened. So, there's never been a fall from grace. I did not fall from grace. And that's what the dream symbolized. And it was really amazing because, and there was this other figure in the dream that was like the tormentor of bonds that was there. Like his, the one that had kidnapped him in the dream, so to speak. But he was just quiet the whole time. Kind of his head was down. He didn't say anything. Barry's kind of looking at him like, what's he going to say? But he was mute. He was mute. He was completely mute during the whole thing. Meaning that aspect of myself, the egoic aspect, doesn't have any more say. I was the one having the say. He didn't say anything. Didn't disagree. He was just sit quiet, just still and quiet, no expression. Just still and quiet, no expression. Meaning evaluation has been flattened out. So when evaluation is flattened out, then you make an offer to yourself, saying, self, come back home. Wake up and realize, wake up, you never left home. You're still playing for me. You never fell into disgrace with me. You're still in my good graces entirely. Man, so Bonds was kind of like, this is amazing. Yeah, maybe I can do this. Maybe he could tell. He wanted to do this. He said, yeah, I believe I'm going to do this. This is what I want to do. This is amazing. And so he's warming up to the idea, thawing out, which means I'm thawing out to my own awakening, that I never fell from grace. I'm still the man, right? Still spirit, still the self, still the one who does everything just right, who's not intimidated by anything. The true professional. I love Bonds with the media. You say, you guys, you don't really know baseball. You don't. You think just writers. You think you know baseball. You don't know what's really going on. You don't know the inside story. You really don't know the game like you think you do. You just don't. And I really can't explain it to you. And he was right. He was right. You know, the knucklehead questions they ask him just to stir up all sorts of controversy, right? So it sells, gets attention. And he knew that. He said, look, I'm not into stirring up controversy like that. We didn't want to waste his time with the media, which was great. A lot of people really loved him for that. And nobody treated the media better than Bonds in terms of putting them in their place, which is great. They should be put in their place. It was just all this nonsense, and he didn't want anything to do with nonsense. And he was all business. He'd come to the ballpark, he was all business. Super, super focused. Totally aware and alert about everything that's going on. That was his passion, that was his profession. He was very proud of it. And, you know, he could read the pictures, he read everything. He could just, like a book, he knew everything that was going on. It was just the pictures knew that this guy has got me figured out, and I don't have a chance. I do not have a chance. If I try to get him out, that ball is going to be hit into the bay. You know, the ball is just going to be crushed. So, the pitcher's out there just shaking. And the manager just says, hey, walk him. Forget it, man. Don't even pitch to him. Forget it. We don't have a chance. That's how well, you know, how prepared he was, how professional he was, how well he read the pitchers, how well he understood the game, and his brilliant eye at the plate, you know, better eye than any umpire. He wouldn't swing anything that wasn't what that he didn't like. It was just He was in control. He was in control of the entire game. Before the game even started, Barry Bonds was in control of that game. Never seen anything like that before. Or since. You just do. Bonds is playing, and he's the man. He's in control. He's controlling this game. Before the game even starts, every game is in order. What an influence. So he had a tremendous impact on the game of baseball. But he was so smart that nobody has really been able to figure out, you know, how he did it. He was so schooled. He was schooled by Willie Mays, his godfather, who was probably the greatest all-around player, most exciting all-around player ever. And so he just, from this immaculate pedigree, he had this like ultimate baseball guru teaching him from the day he was born all the inside scoop on how to, the inside game of baseball, and what's the subtle stuff, that's what's really going on. He was super aware of all the subtleties. Now, I grew up playing baseball, and I was really schooled myself. So I was aware of a lot of subtleties. I could see with Bonds, but Bonds knows way more than I do about baseball, that's for sure. But I could see how he's tuned in to so many little subtle stuff that other players are not tuned into. Having just a feeling where the batter's going to hit the ball when he's out in left field. He just has a feeling like, okay, I know what the pitcher's going to throw. I'm tipped off to it somehow, because they give some signs to tip the outfielders off sometimes if you're sharp. And I know the tendencies. And so I'm going to shade the guy over here. Lo and behold, boom, the ball goes over there. And he makes a diving catch of the ball. Great throw in. He didn't have a powerful arm, but a very accurate and intelligent arm. Great base runner. And he just absolutely had this feel for the game. And 5-2 player all the way around in his entire game. Had this absolute feel for the game like nobody else since Willie Mays, actually. But his, you know, his power was better than Willie Mays, because partly because of the PEDs, but his plate discipline and his speed, bat speed, and how his swing was grooved was better, even better than Willie Mays, as from a hitting standpoint. He had refined what Willie Mays had taught him, and was an even better version of Willie Mays in that regard. It's amazing, absolutely amazing. What a lofty perch he reached in baseball, which we may hardly see again, you know, if ever, actually. So that represents, you know, the self is aware of all the subtlety. Okay, this whole game that's going on here, the self is aware of that. The awake self. So that's what the dream represented. The awake self is that I offered an awakening to myself. I say, and I hey, I want you to come back to play for me. And it was a very audacious thing to do, because I mean, here to offer Barry Bonds to come play for you, people would say, "Are you nuts? He's been gone for 10 years. He's, I don't know how old is he now, but you know, late 40s or something." He can't play anymore. There's not a chance he could possibly do it. But I said, no, yes, he can. Yes, he can play. I'm giving him a spot on my team. I don't care what you say. I want him on my team. I told him that. I said, Barry, I want you on my team no matter what. You know, if you think you can't play, whatever, I don't care. I have a spot for you on my team. That's it. And I'm totally serious. And he started, are you serious? Like, are you really serious? Are you really serious? I said, yes. Yes, 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 and yes. Done deal. Done deal. I'm not backing off of this one bit. So that was a huge wow dream. Super significant dream. And I understood the significance of it. It means this wow practice is really, really working. Flattening evaluation. But I feel in sync with it. You know, it stays. So, because as you work through your path organically of awakening, you feel in sync with what you're doing. So, don't be worried that something too much big is going to happen for you. No, that wasn't. It's not too big for me that would happen. I would just say, oh, this is great. Wow. Very intense, but great. And I'm going with this. Very encouraging. Now, if you're not there where this is happening, then you'd say, oh my gosh, I don't know. I don't think I can handle that. But you will get there. You will get there. Just do the wow practice and trend towards doing the wow practice. Trend. Make sure all your trends are going in that direction. It may take you a while to actually do the practice. But the trending is just as important, because that's what gets you there. Trending in your habits. Trending habits of attention. Your habits of attention is how you trend towards the wow practice. Where do you put your attention? Where do you put your attention? And the whole repentance means let the Holy Spirit guide your attention instead of the ego, instead of your evaluating, instead of your own evaluating, guiding your attention. Let the Holy Spirit guide your attention. This is the key, ultimate key to awakening. Been posting on Facebook just some nice, my own quotes that have come up to me as I go towards awakening. Some wisdom keeps coming up, so I put that on Facebook in these little text pictures. And actually, I've gotten more response to those than anything I've ever posted. You know, 6-7 people like it. Yeah, it's like, wow, that's great. That's great. It's easy to read. I think it's a very nice way to communicate. Big letters, you know, big letters with a color background. And it's quick to do, and they can read it quickly. It's emphasized for them, and it's, you know, something that they appreciate. Some different people are saying, yeah, I like this. So, we'll see. It's a jungle. Facebook's a total jungle. Everyone's post, share, post, share. It's hard to get a word in edgewise. Continuing to get some interesting friend requests. They're all interesting. Right? I mean, we all have our spiritual niche, don't we? Which is okay. But we have to go completely beyond spiritual niches, right, to absolute freedom. We do that by flattening out evaluation. Our niche is fashioned from our evaluations, which are ever-changing and shifting. Ever-changing and shifting. Driven by insecurity, which never departs us as long as we're hallucinating the absence of God. So we're always searching for different value. This one didn't quite work. I need more value or different value. And so we're always changing. Everything's always changing here because of that. It's driven by feeling of insecurity. We think that this is a new creation, but it's something's wrong, that the foundation is insecure. Well, yeah, hallucinating the absence of God is not a secure foundation, because we can stop at any instant. The mind's free. It'll never be a secure foundation. It's a foundation for nothing. Yeah. It's no foundation at all. So, of course we're restless, full of doubt, hope and fear, and always ocean currents of every type are moving us, you know, currents of insecurity are constantly changing our mind this way and that way and that way. And the mind's always chattering and thinking and imagining and hoping and trying and evaluating, trying to evaluate everything. But we can flatten out that evaluation. It's called stilling the mind, is to flatten out evaluation. Practice getting familiar with the same evaluation for every conceivable valuing, every kind of valuing, and every hope and every fear. I hope I'm succeeding. Wow. I fear I'm not succeeding. Wow. And every question. I wonder if this is working. Wow. I wonder if this is not working. Wow. So you could do it a different number of different ways. Good and bad, and then questions, good and bad questions, different questions. Question yourself and then just say, wow. Don't answer the question, just say, wow. Your evaluation of the question is just wow. So evaluate the question. Whatever question you ask is, I wonder what the answer for this is. You start questioning yourself. Just say wow to that. My evaluation of this question is wow. My evaluation of that question is wow. So all the questions that arise within you is wow. All the hopes and fears that arise, wow. All the judgments we have, like this is good, wow. And this is bad, wow. Same evaluation for everything. And so keep searching your mind and the content your mind keeps churning up. your evaluation and just relentlessly apply this wow evaluation to everything that arises. This is the absolute classic core mental practice there is. That's it. Don't need to search for anything else. This is it. And when you flatten that evaluation, you keep flattening it. Keep flattening it. This, the, what we call the mind or the ego, becomes just sort of like inert. Like in that dream, there was this figure there. I said, who is that? They're like inert. They're not saying anything, not doing anything. And that's why I was able to make this offer to Barry, and he started listening to me, because this other person there, his agent or whatever it was, well, it was probably his agent, wasn't saying anything. Inert, inert, inert. And so then you could really start, the awakening can really start happening. You say, hey, you're back on the team. As of now, Barry, you are on my team. And you're my starting left fielder, batting fourth, plain and simple, batting third or batting fourth. And you're starting the next game. That's it. And we don't need to see how it goes. It's going to go great because you never lost it. You never lost anything. So I have faith that this is true. And then he's hearing that faith. It's like the self telling itself, I have faith in yourself. My evaluation is nothing ever happened. There's nothing to evaluate. My evaluation of myself is that there's nothing to evaluate. That's what I was telling. That's what the dream was signifying. There's nothing to evaluate. Everything's the same as it's always been. So what is there to evaluate? All value everywhere, always. So that is what's going on here, which is, you know, very, very encouraging, really, for all of us. Super encouraging. I see, of course, that everyone, I've always known everyone's struggling. Obviously, we're all struggling, okay, really floundering. Trying to find right evaluation instead of no evaluation. That's the whole key to it, is the faith that go toward just no evaluation, nothing to evaluate, nothing's ever happened. I'm exactly the same as I always was. Exactly the same, no evaluation. I don't need to reevaluate myself, okay? So just trust in that. Just tell yourself, I don't need to reevaluate. I haven't changed. There's nothing new to evaluate. I'm exactly the same as I've always been, which is all value everywhere, always. That's what I am. I'm all value everywhere, always. That's what I am. I've always been that and always will be that. So there's nothing new to evaluate. I don't need to add anything. I don't need to subtract anything. No evaluation is necessary. I've used 53 gigabytes. Still a lot. 1,800 still left. Good. I can erase, of course, what I've used any time. So there we go. That's it in a nutshell. And there's a lot of stuff coming up in the world, so we need this. We need the awakening. To be quick, we need to be quick, and so everyone can be encouraged, and I have a feel for it. People are getting desperate, said, where's the value? And more frantic evaluation is going on in the world, which is terrible, terrible. Back in 1963, there wasn't so much evaluating going on. Basically, it's boy meets girl kind of thing. That's about it. And since then, there's just been frantic evaluation going on. Everybody looking for some niche. It's just been frantic. Hell, it's been hell. Not that... Not that it wasn't hell before, but it was not so virulent as it is now. Pretty boring compared to today's, you know, what's going on. Everybody just, you know, massively trying to evaluate massive amounts of trying to figure out, find value, which is, it's just the wrong path entirely. So we've gone away from awakening as a world and a culture, way straight, way far away. And we keep trying to reset ourselves in the dream state where we're dreaming of the situation as if we're not asleep. Okay, but that's a mental image, a memory. And we think that's what we are, but there's no stability there. So the insecurity is still present. So we keep trying, spirituality keeps trying to go back to just the beginning of a dream, not realizing that's still a dream. They think that, we think that the ego, if we trace it back, we can find a place where it was not a dream. No, it's always been a dream. All of the dream is a dream. There's not some part of the dream that is not a dream. So we think that we found value in the dream. We're trying to find value in the dream, which then is, this, again, another starting point to try to fixate hallucination. We don't understand what we're doing. So we're just trying to find some foundation upon which to build. There's no foundation upon which to build in hallucination. Hallucination is totally vulnerable and out to the mind changing its mind. Say, I want to experience something else. I don't want to hallucinate. So there's no way to build a foundation of stability with hallucination. And so there's nowhere to look in a dream to find that stability. So we keep, spirituality keeps trying to find the starting point. So I got to just find, you know, it keeps digging. Where's the foundation in this dream so I can set something solid upon it, you know, and it doesn't exist. It doesn't exist. So that's why most don't take the right approach of practicing in the right way. They're not really trying to wake up. They're just trying to find, where's this doggone foundation in the dream? You know, where's it? Where's the true dream of a real foundation here? There isn't any. There isn't any. You have to realize nothing happened. Nothing ever happened. Which helps us wake from the dream then. We're exactly the same as we've always been. Nothing to evaluate. Nothing to evaluate. Nothing to evaluate at all. That's a very different than what most are doing. Most are not taking the path that leads to awakening. They're trying to come up with a better ego. A spiritualized ego. A spiritualized dream. Spiritualize the dream. Hoping that's... Well, what happens is you hope that... it's like decorating a house that's on a foundation of sand and thinking like, well, if I just read... My problem is I just haven't decorated the house right. And the waves keep hitting the sand, and the sand keeps melting and shifting. Your house, like, whoa. And you get all jittery. Oh my God, my house, what's going on? And then you say, wait a minute, I got to change my curtains. You know, and the tablecloth isn't right. And maybe if I furniture is maybe a little outdated, maybe that's got to be it. And this is what our problem is. We keep redecorating the house instead of recognizing that it's on the foundation of sand, which was a hallucination. There's no way to stabilize hallucination. So what we have to do is get used to flattening evaluation, so our evaluating has just come to a halt, basically. It's just wow. That's all it is. Everything, all other evaluations settle down. The habit of evaluating, we lose interest in it. And then, once we lose interest in it, we can experience reality as it is, where there's nothing to evaluate at all, and it doesn't bother us. We don't get pulled out of it either. We say, oh, yeah, this is how it is. It could never be any other way. I was just hallucinating, trying to stabilize hallucination. How ridiculous. Through trying to use evaluation, believing in disproportionate value. It doesn't exist at all. No reality to it. You lose interest in evaluating. And it's like you just forget all about it. You just forget all about it. There was never anything to evaluate. There was never anything to evaluate. Therefore, I didn't evaluate anything. We've never evaluated anything. We're just pretending to evaluate. But there's nothing to evaluate, actually. And it's just that realization. And so once we just lose interest in this habit of trying to evaluate, we'll just wake up from the dream of evaluation. Very simple, really. I'm not worried about decorating your house, like, you know, right? it's like that's not it's that's not doesn't matter. Our house is always decorated, right? And reality is itself is just intrinsic spaciousness, decorating intrinsic spaciousness, completely stable, intrinsically stable. So, but to bring it back to practice instead of theory, it's this wow practice. Wow, everything that arises, just evaluate. And when you find yourself you've forgotten practicing, here's the key step to take. You say, "Oh, I've forgotten to do the wow practice. Wow. I've remembered to do the wow practice. Wow. I've forgotten to do the wow practice. Wow. I've remembered to do the wow practice. Wow. I've forgotten to do the wow practice. Wow. I remember to do the wow practice. Wow." Okay. And guess what? You're now doing the wow practice. So again, you're going to forget to do the wow practice during the day. So when you catch yourself, say, "Hey, I'm not doing the wow practice. Wow. Hey, I'm not doing the wow practice. Wow. Hey, I am doing the wow practice. Wow." So say the opposite. You know, just go right in the opposite. I'm not doing it. The opposite is I am doing it. And then, wow, both of them exactly the same. Your evaluation exactly the same. So in other words, you're evaluating not doing the wow practice exactly the same as evaluating doing the wow practice. And that is doing the wow practice. That's the genius, though, you see. So I've taken it very deep like this, taking it very deep and seeing that. So everything, you can use everything that arises for the wild practice. And this is the whole point of it. Super effective. Which is what we need now. We need that which is super effective because these spiritual niches just aren't working for us, are they? We've been using those for a long time. And we're tired of them. You know, wow, really tired of it. Really tired of it. The spirituality thing is just exhausting us, and we're just burned out from it. I'm so burned out from spirituality. It's just, let's just go back to 1963, was before spirituality really hit. The big time really was. And like, wow, we just don't need, church age is over, right? Jesus is back. We don't really need spirituality anymore. We have very clear explanations and prescriptions of what to do. Do the wow practice, flatten your expectations. So it's getting very, very simple, very, very clear. We don't need all the spirituality now. We just need to wake up. Okay? That's all we need to do. Maybe it'll happen. It could. It could. Because we're under the pressure right now. Now, I'm still pushing. I'm pushing for some situational shift for myself. You know, day goes by. It's another day. Lost opportunity for that. So I did practice a little bit. Did weight swinging, simulating a golf swing with weights, and then I swung my forewood like I did my driver yesterday, and was able to do the same alignment, proper alignment with it kind of thing. I practiced that a little bit. I'll practice it more tomorrow, I guess. And so I'm still tweaking everything, refining everything, getting mentally prepared just for a, you know, shift of some sort. Shift in effectiveness of some sort. You know, back in the game, back playing my game, back on the field that I excel on. Get back to that, out of spirituality, which I don't excel in spirituality at all. I was lost like a fish out of water. I don't excel in spirituality. That started in probably 1964, the Beatles, the rise of spirituality. And no, I'm no good at it. I don't even like it, actually. I mean, a lot of people are good at that niche sort of thing, but I'm not. I'm good at awareness. Being awake is what I'm good at. So goodbye to spirituality. You know, good riddance, really. Good riddance. So no more spirituality? Wow. More spirituality? Wow. No more spirituality? Wow. Lots more spirituality? Wow. So I'm finished with spirituality? Wow. I'm not finished with spirituality. Wow. I've awakened. Wow. I haven't awakened. Wow. I've awakened. Wow. I haven't awakened. Wow. See that? Apply this flattening evaluation to everything. No sacred cows. No sacred cows. Look for those sacred cows and find them, and then use this practice on them, and you will realize this is it. This really is what works. Finally, after wallowing through a swamp of spirituality for 53 years, really started in 1964 with the British invasion of the U.S. now, and the drag of Alistair, whatever his name is, Crowley or something, and then all this weird spirituality started with the Beatles, really got started really weird. They were really into some very weird magic stuff with Alistair, whatever his name is, Crowley or something, some very bizarre British esoteric magician kind of type. Was, yuck from the very beginning. The Beatles were heavily influenced. They were very much into spirituality. The Beatles were the ones who really began this huge push of spirituality, and we're going back before that now. Dion was before the Beatles. He was the king before the Beatles, him and Elvis. But Dion had a, you know, he was, by that time Elvis was not quite as hip, but Dion had this, he had it, you know, right then. He was just in the groove. So this helps, listening to that helps me reorient back before spirituality and get back to before I fell under the spell of spirituality. Because I'm waking up now from spirituality. So I'm sort of reconnecting with 1963 and how I felt in 1963. I feel the same way now. I will feel exactly the same, basically. Or maybe better. I'll feel better. I told Barry Bonds, you'll be better than you used to be. You'll be a lot better, actually. So I'll feel even better. I'll know what's going to happen. You know, precognition will return. All that stuff will return. I just say, yeah, of course. I'll just be in the groove. I might even be able to sing along with Dion. Donna the Prima Donna. I might be able to sing that. I'm close, but, you know, I'll get it. And other stuff. Sandy is really another good song. It's like, but wow, is that difficult to sing like Dion. He'll leave you in the dust if you're not up to speed. That's for sure. It really sings the heck out of it. Like, that's a great challenge. I love it. I feel like it's 1963, actually. Can I get down 163 pounds? I don't know. That'd be very slim. I ate a lot today. I kind of felt like I needed to. I was feeling kind of weak. And so I'm not trying to do crash diet. But feeling pretty slim. Feeling pretty good. Feeling like 1963. Just if you weren't there, just take all the spiritualities in the world right now. None of it was here. Okay, none of it was here at all. Ram Maharshi was here. A few people knew that. And Jiddu Krishnamurti was here. People knew that. Okay, so and Theosophy was here in the world. And so there was some spirit. New Mind was here. So there was spirituality. But what you see now in the world, basically, it just didn't exist at all. The New Age thing didn't exist. There was no such word as New Age at all. None. New Age is just the age of spirituality, is all it is. So, we're going back to 1963. Wow. We're not going back to 1963. Wow. We're finished with spirituality. Wow. We're not finished with spirituality. Wow. So apply positive and negative to every situation. If you come up with some really positive thing, wow, make sure you apply the opposite, the negative, and use the same evaluation to it. Okay, we're not trying to evaluate properly. We're trying to flatten all evaluation. Reality doesn't require any evaluation. There's no such thing as right evaluation of reality. No such thing as right evaluation of reality. It's all perfect. It's all value everywhere, always. Nothing to evaluate. Everything is in the flow. Everything is in the now. Everything is in the groove. It's just, the groove is everywhere. There's no way you can ever get out of it. Right? You are the all grooved one. Right? Yeah. You are the all grooved one. And that's really groovy. I don't think that term groovy existed either in 63. Feeling groovy. What, 59th Street Bridge song, or what is that? Something like that. But things went bad starting in 1964. It just really we made a big attempt to find our niche, right? Had to do your own thing, find your niche. No, don't find any niche. You're not in any niche at all. We're not in any niche at all. We're absolutely free of any niche. There's no niche at all. I'm absolute freedom. I'm totally niched everywhere. Everywhere is my niche. Yeah. So I'm trying to be very disciplined, stay with my good habits, no more surfing, no baseball, no sports, no TV, radio, no internet, except Facebook and YouTube, and on and on and on. I know this, know this, know this, know this, know this. It's really important. It's play of attention, play of attention. Your attention has to be on this practice. It's all important. That's why good habits are so important. Good habits mean play of attention. The Holy Spirit is coalescing your attention. It is reducing it, so to speak. It's simplifying it all down so you can put your attention on this practice ultimately. So all these good habits are very important. I mean, the church age is very important to boil all our habits down, boil our attention down, so it's closer and closer and closer to right practicing. As I said, pagan times, many gods, many sacrifices. Old Testament, one God, many sacrifices. New Testament, one God, one sacrifice. Of Course in Miracles, one God, no sacrifice. And then Apex Yoga is no evaluation, same evaluation for everything. Many gods, many sacrifices, one God, many sacrifices, one God, one sacrifice, one God, no sacrifice. If Apex Yoga, wow to all of it. Just wow to all. Same evaluation, all of it. So there, we needed to consolidate the sacrifices over the last couple thousand years, and at least Western Christianity, and pretty much around the world, have gone through similar progressions. Is that we simplify? Just know there's just one sacrifice. So your attention is not constantly on all these sacrifices and just one God. So your attention is not constantly distracted by all these different gods. One God, one sacrifice. That enables us to simplify our evaluations, simplify our evaluations. Our attention was able to settle down to the point where we finally go, one God, no sacrifice. And then take it to the ultimate. It's like, wait a minute, no evaluation at all. There's nothing to evaluate. So your attention is resting on no evaluation, constantly resting on no evaluation, no evaluation, or just the term for no evaluation is wow. We're just using one evaluation to basically say, I'm not evaluating at all. If you use one evaluation for everything, you're not really evaluating, right? It may seem like it is. You can say, well, I'm evaluating, but it really is just your flattening evaluation. So, wow to everything, every situation. I'm doing great, wow. I'm doing lousy, wow. I'm waking up, wow. I'm not waking up, wow. I'm really focused, wow. I'm really scared, my mind's scattered really bad, wow. See, all the negatives, all the positives, bring them up together and wow all of them, one after the other like that. And you'll feel very different. You'll feel calm, and not, don't even label how you feel. I feel calm, wow. I feel jittery, wow. Just practice. Don't label, just practice. So this is really working, wow. This is not working at all, wow. So turn whatever dialogue you're starting in your mind, just turn it into the wow practice. And then you're doing a great job. You're practicing, you're doing exactly what you need to do. Whew. So always the intensity is on right now, isn't it? Wow, it's just Tensity's always on. Wow, the tensity's not on at all. Wow. I really want to finish. Wow. I really don't want to finish. Wow. I wonder what's going to happen. Wow. I don't really wonder what's going to happen. Wow. I really want this. Wow. I don't really want this at all. Wow. I want to wake up. Wow. I don't want to wake up. Wow. I want to stay asleep. Wow. I really want to wake up from dreaming. Wow. No matter what position you're taking, just says, wow, my evaluation is wow. 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 And just keep doing that relentlessly, relentlessly, relentlessly like that. Don't expect any results at all. I expect a lot of results. Wow. I don't expect any results. Wow. I expect great results. Wow. I expect lousy results. Wow. This is really important. Wow. This has no importance whatsoever. Wow. I'm really going to be helped by this. Wow. I'm not going to be helped at all by this. Wow. This is my life's purpose. Wow. I'm totally failing to see my life's purpose in this. Wow. I'm really on track. Wow. I'm really totally off track. Wow. Now, never have we ever practiced like this, used our thinking like this, have we, our evaluating? Never. We've never even thought about doing this. So we're going to feel a little woozy, like, whoa. I'm starting to feel that way now. I'm like, wow. Full stop in the wow when you get like this. Wow. How do I feel? Wow. What's going on? Wow. What should I do? Wow. Wow, wow, wow. Just wow. Like this sort of shock. I sort of feel shocked by this. It's a way to use our mind, you know, thinking we never thought possible, never even imagined it. And yet we're doing it. And it's easy. We say, oh my gosh. Wow, this is really working. Wow, this isn't working at all. Wow. Finally I have hope. Wow. I got no hope whatsoever. Wow. I've been absolute despair over this practice. Wow. I'm elated over this practice. Wow. I'm in despair. Wow. I'm elated. Wow. Success is mine. Wow. I'm failing terribly. Wow. See, we're used to clinging to an evaluation instead of just the same evaluation. We are not used to this. It's like empty hands. It's just my hands are, I'm not grasping any hold of anything. I've got it. I finally got it. Wow. I'm totally missing it. Wow. I'm still got no clue. Wow. I'm totally dialed in now. Wow. Totally dialed in. Wow. I've got no clue. Wow. I'm totally dialed in. Wow. I've got no clue. Wow. So this is way more intense than Facebook here, these videos, right? They just get a little blurb and then you can change the next one and it's gone. But here we're hammering and hammering and hammering and hammering and hammering it. So this is really where it's at. This is where it's at. I need to post my YouTube URL on Facebook more often so people can come here and see that this is where it's at. This is where it's really at. This is ground zero. This is where it's at. This is where it's really at. Wow. This is a joke. There's nothing going on here at all. Wow. This is a waste of time. Wow. This is the best way to spend your time. Wow. No sacred cows. Wow. Many sacred cows. Wow. No sacred cows. Wow. Many sacred cows. Wow. I apply this to everything. Wow. I make all sorts of exceptions. Wow. See, this is completely outside the box of our expectations that we're using the mind this way. Completely outside the box. And so we're just like meltdown. Like, whoa. Wow. No evaluation is going on. Wow. Lots of evaluation is going on. Wow. This is really funny. Wow. This isn't funny at all. Wow. This is kind of scary. Wow. This, I feel so confident. Wow. I can do this easily. Wow. This is like super tough for me. Wow. This is just like impossible. Wow. This is really easy. Wow. So this is starting to get to me. This practice, I can feel it. My mind is like, whoa, yeah, it's just holy cow. Wow, full stop in the wise, really getting to me. You can feel that when you practice this way. You really hit it like we've been hitting it here. This example is hitting it hard. And at some point you say, okay, I'm gonna ease off of it. That's enough. Good Lord, that's enough. Wow, no, it's not enough. I'm doing great. Wow. I've done enough. Wow. And I feel like doing a lot more. Wow. I feel kind of shocked. Wow. I don't feel shocked at all. Wow. So 63, we're figuring, should we end our evaluation, this dream now, or should we have one more drink, last call? And the world decided, last call, we'll have more drink, another drink, one final drink. But we were in 63, we were thinking, you know, we don't have to go through all the spirituality. We don't have to do this. We decided to get drunk one more time. Things are pretty boring. We could have woken up back in 63, actually. But the last call thing got us, didn't it? Dangerous time, right before some troubles, world troubles, tribulation period, etc. It's like, oh my gosh, you know, I gotta hold on to the world. I gotta hold on to our evaluating. You know, let me try evaluation one last time. That kind of thing. Let me just give it. Get one last full effort and see if I can spiritualize hallucination. And that's what we did. That's what we did. It's exactly what we did. And now we realize what we did. And we say, okay, done with that. Done with that. Barry, you're back on the team. In fact, you never left. You've been my starting left fielder all along, and you're hitting better than you've ever hit. That's a fact. And so we just pick up where we left off. Just pick up where we left off. And this, now we decide, now no more evaluating, no more trying to spiritualize hallucination. Peace of God time right now, okay? Easy, easy. It's just that simple. Just lose interest in spirituality. And of course, you don't want to spiritualize losing interest in spirituality. So you say, losing interest in spirituality, wow. Not losing interest in spirituality, wow. Losing interest in spirituality, wow. Not losing interest in spirituality, wow. Losing interest in spirituality, wow. Maintaining interest in spirituality, wow. So don't get caught in evaluating non-evaluation. Non-evaluation, wow. Evaluation, wow. Non-evaluation, wow. Evaluation, wow. Non-evaluation, wow. Evaluation, wow. Non-evaluation, wow. Evaluation, wow. Same flattening, you see? So far it hasn't caught on, this wow practice on Facebook. I keep hinting, and it doesn't quite catch on because they're all trying to evaluate non-evaluation. So, yeah. They're right there, but flattening evaluation has not quite occurred to them. They talk about it, but they don't do it. So in other words, they're evaluating. Yeah, this is a great thing to do. No. It's a great thing to do. Wow. It's not a great thing to do. Wow. It's a great thing to do. Wow. It's not a great thing to do. Well, as soon as you say it's a great thing to do, you're evaluating. So we're flattening all evaluation. It's not like in reality you say, oh, this is a great thing. I evaluate this as really a great thing to do. No, it's all good in reality. It's all perfect. It's all perfect. It's all perfect, always, everywhere. So the habit of evaluation has to be set down every which way. Even evaluating non-evaluation, that's got to be set down. So that's the block that everyone's running into. And the wow practice, just takes us right past that block. Just like driving into a new realm. Easy. The highway's right there. Yeah. Wow. This really knocked me out, this practice. I'm really buzzed by it. I don't know what to say. Wow. I don't know what to say. Wow. I do know what to say. Wow. I'm really buzzed by it. Wow. I'm not buzzed by it at all. I feel calm. Wow. Whew. It's getting cold. I've got a t-shirt here and it's like, what, 11 o'clock at night. Beautiful, beautiful day, California. Expect a couple more before the rain comes. Like an inch of rain coming over like 4 or 5 days. And then it clears up again for a while and then some more rain next week. So April showers bring May flowers. And this is just going to give a jolt of more moisture, more greenery for California. It's really going to just keep perking it up more and more and more. Just greenery everywhere. But wow, we're not interested in that right now. We're interested in this practice because this is just, I'm just, wow. I don't know what to say. Wow. I do know what to say. Wow. I don't know what to say. Wow. I do know what to say. Wow. I don't know what to say. Wow. I do know what to say. Wow. You see how easy it is to keep this practice going continuously. Sri Sri Nandamayama said you must develop your practice so it becomes continuous. And this is what it's become. The wow practice easily becomes continuous. Easily. That's the goal. When she says, when you can do that, then you are. Yeah. All right. Nothing can be said about it, really, right? Yeah. You're going to wake up. I'm going to wake up. Wow. I'm not going to wake up. Wow. My practice is continuous. Wow. My practice is all fragmented. Wow. I'm doing great. Wow. I'm doing lousy. Wow. You see how it can go? Wow. I don't see how it can go. I see how it can go. Wow. I don't see how it can go. Wow. This is absolutely fabulous. Wow. This is just inconsequential. Wow. This is absolutely fabulous. Wow. This is totally inconsequential. Wow. Fabulous. Wow. Terrible, wow, fabulous, wow, terrible. Wow. So full stop in the wow from this, full stop in the wow. Okay? Full stop in the wow.